Cosmo Clifford.
This is Stu Cook from Creedence Clearwater. You're watching
Talk and Roll. It's on the t-shirt, baby.
Yeah. That's right. Roll.
Good evening and welcome to Talk and Roll. Tonight on Talk and Roll, we have the rhythm section of undoubtedly one of America's greatest bands, Creedence Clearwater Revival. But now they are Creedence Clearwater Revisited. It's Cosmo and Stu.
Evening, folks.
Howdy.
By the way, gentlemen, how did you two first meet and when did you first meet? You go back a long time, so.
We met the first day of the seventh grade in homeroom, the letter C. And started hanging, well, at first we sized each other up like a couple of tough guys. Yeah. And then we started hanging out with each other and getting in trouble and sharing our music collection with each other. And it wasn't until the eighth grade when we hooked up with John Fogerty and formed the Blue Velvets, our first band and instrumental trio.
Yeah, and the information I got is that you were actually playing piano before you switched to bass.
I was a trumpet player originally, and then I became a piano player. And I was a piano player in the band, but always played a little guitar on the side. And so as we got older, we started playing in beer bars around the UC Berkeley campus, and then I played guitar, sort of the low strings of the guitar. And when Tom eventually joined the band full time in about 1965, then we had too many guitar players. So John suggested I try the bass, and I've been a bass player since 65.
And who was the big musical influence back then on you, gentlemen?
Well, there were so many influences, but basically the roots music. And we were fortunate in the Bay Area to have it was a melting pot really from World War II. They had a big shipbuilding plant in Richmond. So the workforce came out from the South and places like that, brought their music with them. And so there were actual radio stations where we could get the authentic country music and authentic R&B music. And that's what we liked. And then we listened to the Top 40 and get to hear Little Richard and Fats Domino, Elvis, I mean, all the great music of the 50s, and that's what we decided we wanted to play.
My first big experience, the one I still remember the most, was going to a Ray Charles concert.
Wow.
My folks got my brother and I tickets as a Christmas present. Ooh. To see Ray Charles at the Berkeley Community Theater, and I never forgot it ever since then. And that's when I really got enthused about piano, and the tune What I Say.
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned that song, because someone says that song is actually, they consider that the first real soul song when they started coining that phrase, soul music. They consider that song the start of soul.
One really did it for me. I learned to play that.
Awesome. Would you guys agree with that? Maybe that
was one of them.
It's in the neighborhood.
It's one of the top two. Ooh,
It was just hair on the arm. And the second record, first record I bought was Roll With Me Henry by Etta James. I was nine. It was a 78.
Yeah.
That was real R&B. And then the second record I bought, another 78 of course, was Bo Diddley by Bo Diddley. And then I didn't know, I loved the music. I was nine, so I wasn't thinking about playing an instrument so much. But I was captivated by that drum beat and the rolling tom-toms. I mean, it implanted something in there.
I was fortunate to see him in the 70s in Kenmore Square in Boston. That was a thrill of mine. It's so, I just love his music. He's so influential.
Yeah, and he's a good guy.
The Stones especially.
One of the biggest guys was Chuck Berry. He was the biggest influence.
Yeah. He lets everybody know about that too.
Chuck's credited for tooting his horn for sure, but
not the most humble.
When you look back at the string of hits that he had,
I know
they were obviously directed at the suburban white kids.
Yeah,
and they connected.
He was smart.
One of them.
Yeah. And really, it wasn't so much. To me, it was more rock and certainly more rock and roll than R&B. I mean, it actually almost had sort of a surfer type, not quite that defined, but I mean, it was different than most black musicians. I mean, it was very, very comfortable music for dads. My dad didn't let me play my records when he was around.
Yeah.
More the latter, yeah. I think. Yeah. Our personal styles have grown out of the music that mm-hmm. we originally liked and listened to. Mm-hmm. And so...
Because people when
that
they...
That was applied to the material at hand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When people talk about you guys, they always... You coined that phrase, the swamp sound. You know, it's like, you know, I mean, I know you guys are
California
sick of hearing that, yeah, California thing. I mean, we had, you had the psychedelic thing going there too, and you guys were miles apart from that stuff,
yeah, right?
Right? Yeah, so.
You do have something in common, if I remember correctly, with James Brown. I believe both Creedence and James Brown, at least on Billboard, never had a number one, but tons of number two.
We have we beat out James on that one. We have more number twos than anybody. I still think that record holds today. Go figure. But one of the problems that we had is we had double-sided hits. So you cut that. If it was just one side, it would have been number one. Mm-hmm. But when you're splitting it, and that also speeds up the process of your workload, because it's double time, really. You're putting out what are two singles, but at the same time,
mm-hmm.
instead of this one's here, this one's here, that's 6 months usually, and when you add it times, we had five of those, so that's a lot of time that was used up by having double-sided hits. It was a nice tip of the hat to us. We were making good records, obviously, but better than we wanted, actually.
Right. But you guys did have a number one record in Great Britain.
Oh, yeah.
Bad Moon Rising. Bad Moon Rising.
Well, we had a lot of number ones in other countries.
Yeah, sure.
But
a lot of number one albums here.
Yeah. We had two number one albums, and we had several other top fives. I think William made it to three or four. But Green River was our first number one album. Cosmos Factory was our second, and that was number one for 12 weeks.
Yeah, Green River was released by a record company the same summer of the Woodstock Festival, right? I mean, it was kind of like before Woodstock released.
Yeah.
So you guys were riding high on the charts. And I think Bob and I talked about this earlier. Out of all the bands that were on stage, right, you guys were probably more commercially successful at that time on the charts than any of those other bands. And
I think so.
Why was your time slot so in the middle of the night? Why did they do that?
The show was running late because of the weather and the technical problems. I think it was we remembered it as three, but according to the film, it was sometime shortly after one when we got on stage. We were supposed to, that made it Sunday, but we were supposed to play Saturday. We were supposed to headline Saturday night, play about 10 o'clock, I think,
mm-hmm.
and it. For all those reasons, it didn't work out that way, and we played our set to it was totally dark. There was no, by then they'd shut the spotlights down because of fear of electrical shock,
and
half the stage lights weren't working, half the audio wasn't working, but we played our show. I thought we did a good show.
I know there's the little controversy was that somebody thought your performance was trash, but I think you guys thought you kicked ass.
Oh, John Fogerty thought it was trash.
Yeah.
We kicked
that. That's somebody.
But I've seen some. I think it's pretty damn good for, like you said, the equipment that was available back then, and the time of night, darkness.
Well, you have rain and electronics, so a lot of stuff was wounded on stage.
Uh-huh.
You know, and at any moment it could have blown up. But so what? We're there.
I know.
What are we going to do? We're going to play.
We have three songs, 15 minutes of music in the 40th anniversary.
Finally.
Yeah.
So, the 25th, nothing, and then, we won't regret that.
Well, we almost made it to the 25th. We got to, the day before.
Don't go around tonight when it's bound to take your life. There's a bad moon on the rise. I hear hurricanes are blowing. I know the end is coming soon. Don't come around tonight, but it's bound to
And you both worked with a legendary, unfortunately passed away, Doug Song.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I did 3 projects with Doug. I produced 2 of them. It's always a joy and a lot of hard work working with Doug. He's just so talented that he's like a bee going from flower to flower. I said, now we got to finish the blues song before we can get into the rock and roll song. Okay, but anyway.
It was in Eugene, Stockholm, I think, of all places.
Yeah, we did Meet Me in Stockholm. Was a number one hit single.
Wow. And,
I went over and did a little tour with him on that one. I mean, he was just a brilliant talent. I wish more people knew about how great a talent he was. Unique individual,
say the least. They put the mold on that guy. Yeah.
One of the craziest guys
I've
ever met.
One of the most talented people I ever met.
Yeah.
Wow.
Just gifted, soulful people.
Yeah, just a brilliant, brilliant talent.
And there's Booker T and the MGs. You guys.
Oh, yeah.
What can you say about
Duck?
Ducky.
I just saw a video of. You both in that video with Booker T, or is it just you, Stu?
Yeah, I was a syndicated special from '70 with Tom Dooley.
I was playing. Because Al Jackson was.
Where
were
you situated?
I was at the factory.
At the factory.
Oh, that's that cluster.
The cluster. Yeah.
Well, they should release that. Do you think that'll ever get released on video?
No.
I hope it won't happen either.
Well, it was just a loose jam.
It wasn't supposed to be.
No, that was syndicated for television. Wasn't it?
Well, it was in a television show that was syndicated for TV. Okay. It was part of that show. It was a documentary.
The part that was in the show was practically the only musical part, in other words, where people actually were playing together.
Yeah.
A lot of the stuff that the record company unwisely put on some remastered versions of our original albums has some pretty embarrassing stuff on it.
Bonus tracks, yeah.
Yeah, the bogus tracks.
We call them bogus tracks.
I want to ask Stu a question here. Stu, as a bass player, I know you kind of scoff at this, but I love this guy. He's one of my favorite bass players from even now. And the song Fortunate Son, I mean, that riff in there is incredible. And I keep hearing it. It still sends a chill up my spine, because if you listen to that song and that opening of his bass, right, you know exactly what song is coming on. You know, and if you don't, then you don't know anything about rock and roll, because as soon as Stu hits that bass, that's the song, Fortunate Son.
It's a rhythm section solo in front there.
Yeah.
And start out and then the drums, Cosmo comes in, and then off to the races.
Yeah. Big song.
Starts with the bass, actually.
Does it?
I mean, so many people love that song.
Make a bet?
Yeah.
$100?
Yeah. Live, it starts with the bass.
Live, it starts with the bass.
Yeah.
On the record, baby.
Yeah.
Sessions you gentlemen have done that your fans might not know about over the years, sessions with other artists?
Maybe the Doug Somm stuff. I mean, 3 albums with Doug, but and then we did the Don Harrison Band. There's some good records there.
That's right.
Good tracks. We did 2 albums there on the Atlantic album label.
Yeah.
And in fact, I was listening to some of that in my room the last couple of days, and there's some little gems in there.
And Stu produced 15 songs for what they call the psychedelic godfather of music, Mr. Rocky Erickson.
That's right.
And amazing. Rocky Erickson and the Aliens. Right. That amazing
story. Did it run smoothly?
Yeah. that was in the late 70s, early 80s. That's quite some time now. That stuff's still available. I mean, it's been reissued and repackaged, and there's a DVD that goes with it now as well. I also spent 3 hours playing with the Rolling Stones.
Some
years back, they asked me to audition for them.
Yeah. So you got to meet Bill Wyman?
No, Bill Wyman was the guy that wasn't there.
Oh.
I was Bill Wyman for the day.
You really? I never knew that.
Yeah.
That's great.
So that was fun.
Well, how were they to work with? They good.
They were. Yeah? They treated me well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So it was fun. They finally threw me out when I kept I kept asking to you know play another one and get them out.
Back in the old days, did you guys really have to be on your guard? This is kind of serious. To be on your guard about getting dosed and spiked.
Oh,
you,
boy.
How did you avoid that?
I got dosed at the Fillmore
by the Grateful Dead, and
this was the West, Fillmore West.
Yeah.
Someone handed you a Carousel Ballroom.
We had a policy, and actually they were the main reason for it, because before we made it, we went to the Fillmore, and we were watching the local bands. The Dead was one of them, and they were so stoned that they weren't even in tune. Now, come on.
Yeah,
and it was, and afterwards they were saying that's the best we've ever played, and we're looking at each other going, "Holy cow!" So we made a pact on the floor of the Fillmore: we'll never use drugs or alcohol when we're playing, and we didn't, and that included work, rehearsals, and anything you did, if you were going to do anything, you did it on your own time, and then it couldn't.
Good for you guys.
Affect the work. Peers called us the Boy Scouts of Rock and Roll, and they used to poke fun at us, and you'll never make it playing that music, and we ended up being the biggest band that ever came out of the Bay Area. But I ran into some of those guys later on, and they said, we used to, put you guys down and do this and do that. And they said, but you guys kept cranking the singles out, and we would say, you're copping out. And they said, we would have killed to have a single. talked to some of the guys in the Dead, and they said, we would have cut our, off to have a single. Just one real hit like you guys ran. You were just pounding them out. So it's interesting. But I did get dosed, and the thing that saved me is the light show was behind us. Thank God for that. Woo!
I know. You guys were... Hey,
not a nice
wise move on your part. You know, people won't believe that story because of the stories that float around about the 60s and bands and stuff, right? They say, but hey, it shows.
Yeah.
You guys, your work is beyond, incredible. Still holding up today. I mean, still selling records, the old stuff is still... Yeah. People love it.
Great, exactly.
Well, I think our best, proudest accomplishment, at least for me, is we have three generations, and I see it. I gave an autograph to a 10-year-old last night.
I know, isn't that amazing?
And he was singing the words of the song. So we've got a very young fan base now, if you average it out between our generation and the other two and a half down here. So it's great. We have a lot of young people, and they bring a great energy to the shows. And you can see whole families, grandpa, dad, and the kids.
So it's the old adage, good music transcends the generations.
And it's easy to relate to.
Yeah.
I ain't no fortunate son. I mean, what are your favorite Creedence albums?
Yeah.
What are your favorite albums?
Well, guess what mine is.
Cosmo.
There we go.
Cosmo's Factory.
That was mine up there.
Bayou Country for
Hold up. This one here is my favorite.
That's my favorite.
Really, you too. I knew this was Cosmos's favorite because this my favorite song, not only a Creedence song, but I think in rock and roll history. This is in my top five or six. At times, I think it is just such an incredible song. And I was watching your drumming
from the Bayou.
And I was watching your drumming in that record at the Royal Albert Hall performance. I mean, you can tell you love the song.
Oh, that's my favorite Creedence song.
Yeah, I know. like your 52nd show of the year so far. You guys realize how many shows you've done so far on tour? Yeah. 52nd. I think I just did a quick count, but I mean, if you look back 45 years, I mean, do you think you guys would be doing like 100 plus shows and like now?
Well, we're not doing 100 shows now. No. We were yeah. doing 100 yeah. shows now, and my wife yeah. said, that's really not a good idea. And because we were gone yeah. two-thirds yeah. of the time. And mm-hmm. I said, you're yeah. right. And yeah. we all got together, and we do 75. And
that's still a lot.
Yeah. But it's yeah. not 100. Right. So mm-hmm. it's 50 more days home with your family. Yeah. And I think it's kept us going, really. It's easy to burn out. The road is not easy. Great. So we do 75, and that gets us around. Yeah. We've done two foreign tours already uh-huh. this year, and
as long as it's still fun.
Well, that's it. I want it to be fun, and that's why the number one reason why I'm out here, and I'm having fun. Probably more fun right now than I have since the project started.
Isn't that part of the reason you should be playing is having fun?
Yes, yep. That's the only reason.
We don't need to do this from a yeah. bank book, checking book mm-hmm. perspective, but. We do it because it's a gas.
Yeah, nothing like it.